The Night Cage is a creepy cooperative board game about trying to escape a maze where you only have limited light and where you find the maze has changed if you retrace your steps. This is a great game for horror-themed game nights.
The Night Cage comes from the minds of Chris McMahon, Roswell Saunders, and Christopher Ryan Chan, who was also the artist responsible for creeping us all out. The game was published back in 2021 from Smirk and Dagger Games and should be available anywhere you can find hobby board games.
The Night Cage is a cooperative game for 1 to 5 players, which features a variety of gameplay modes and scalable difficulty. Games usually take about an hour, and the wait increases the more optional ways to play you include.
Now, the Night Cage is an oubliette that you and your fellow players find yourself stuck in. Its low ceilings force you to crawl, and all you have with you is a single candle, which only illuminates your immediate area and just a little bit further out. Your collective goal is to each collect a key and discover a gate to exit the maze. Then all escape together. But your path will be blocked by pits, crumbling paths, monsters like the horrific wax eaters, the pathless, the dirge, and more. Can you escape before your candle burns out?
Check out the creepy cool artwork and the component quality in the Night Cage through our unboxing video on YouTube.
While the dark artwork is the real standout here, I've found the rest of the components to be equally well done. Player markers in different candle shapes and colors, actual little metal skeleton keys, clear iconography, and a great flowchart on the back of the rulebook for keeping track of everything you need to watch during a turn.
Speaking of what to watch on a turn, let's move on to an overview of play.
So put the board out with the side up for the appropriate player count. Fill the candle tile holder with tiles as instructed in the rulebook, which is based on what optional rules you're playing and how many people are playing. Each player then places a starting tile and a candle marker on the board in any open spot, then draws and places 2 tiles from the candle holder that go off that starting tile. Each player then takes a nerve token and you're ready to go.
Each turn, players only have 2 options, move or stay. If they stay, they get to collect a nerve token, but they still burn wax, discarding 1 tile from the tile holder. Movement is 1 space, only from the tile you are on to a connecting tile.
Now, the board is now updated based on your new position. First, you're going to remove any tiles no longer illuminated. Each player's candle only illuminates the tile they're on and those directly adjacent, and some with a snuffed-out candle only illuminates where they are. You then draw new tiles and illuminate the new spots you've unlocked, new passages that showed up once you moved.
New tiles can include more corridors, some of which are crumbling, pits, key tiles, as each player needs to collect 1 key before you can all exit, gates, you all have to gather at a single gate with keys to win, and horrific monsters. To make all of this even more interesting, when you move away from a tile and it's no longer illuminated, it's discarded. So when you go back, that corridor will lead to something else.
Now, the base game includes 1 type of monster called the Wax Eater, who will snuff out the candle of anyone who moves into their line of sight. This not only makes navigation harder, but also removes extra tiles from the tile stack.
Thankfully, your characters are brave and have nerve. Nerve can be spent to move again, to stay if your candle is out, to reduce the damage of monsters, to actually attack some of the advanced monsters, and to keep the group's candle burning during the final flickers. When the tile stack runs out and everyone starts removing tiles from the board at the end of their turns.
Now, everyone loses the game if all 4 gate tiles are lost, because then you know there's no more gates to be found. If the prisoners can't each collect a key, or if they can't gather at the gate before the darkness isolates them.
Well, that's the basic game. The advanced game adds 2 more monsters. The first are keepers. These replace the key tiles in the base game. Now you need to capture your keys from monsters. Thankfully, they are blind from the back. Next are pit fiends, which when revealed, turn every tile diagonally away from them into pits.
Now for an even greater challenge, you can add in 1 or more boss monsters. The core game includes 2 of these, the pathless and the dirge. The pathless are a nastier version of the wax eaters. They ignore walls and pits. And the dirge is, well, huge and scary, and you can see it in our unboxing video. But other than that, we'll leave that one for you to discover on your own.
There is one more optional rule that you can use in either version of the game, and that's limited communication, where only players who are in connecting corridors can talk to each other. This one makes the game more difficult, but does help with quarterbacking.
And speaking of quarterbacking, I think it's time to start sharing our thoughts, since to me, quarterbacking is the biggest potential problem with the Night Cage. This is especially true once the monsters start showing up. I don't know what it is about this game compared to other cooperative games, including like classics like Pandemic, but quarterbacking is very prevalent and easy to do. It is more common in this game than I've seen in any other cooperative game. Like I have a feeling it's that feeling of desperation and anxiety this game inspires while playing it that makes you want to help the other players.
Yeah, the limited knowledge everyone has certainly leads to a level of desperation, and it's hard not to try and do everything you can to succeed when, more than in many co-op games, it just feels like an inevitability that you're going to lose. And you want to beat back the loss as much as you do the darkness.
Now, if you or your group doesn't like players telling other players what to do on their turns, be sure to put that limited communication rule in place sooner rather than later, possibly even your first game. Yes, it makes the game a little more difficult, but it also adds a level of immersion to the game, and it prevents players from telling other players what to do, at least until they've kind of hooked up. And honestly, once you've hooked up, there's probably less quarterbacking required because you won't need as much advice.
That said, be aware of the grunts and groans from players who can't communicate with you, but still disapprove of your choices. This can potentially be more harsh than just having to listen to them give advice or suggestions.
Now, the other potential problem with the Night Cage is the theme here. It's creepy. And honestly, like if you really look at it, downright twisted. But I love it. I fully get that this is not for everyone, though. There are going to be people who do not like this theme. Now, I've mentioned games in the past that were too much for my kids. Well, this was not one of them. They were perfectly fine with the dark creepiness of the Night Cage. Actually, they were all over it. After first playing, Gwen's sketchbook was a little gothic in nature for the coming week.
Yeah, I can, however, see how this game will be too much for some folks. Not because of the art as much as the tone it creates as a game. That desperation we mentioned can be oppressive and lead to a level of anxiety in some people that may outlast the game. It is certainly something to keep an eye on for younger players especially.
Now, another thing to be aware of, this is not a good or a bad, is that the game can get a little fiddly. There's a reason there's a literal flowchart on the back of the rulebook. It can be very easy to forget one of the steps. Like the actual actions are, I don't move or I move one tile, right? That sounds simple enough, but it's very easy to forget to discard a tile that is now in darkness or to remember to reveal all of the tiles around your board, your where you moved, especially because the board wraps around that I found often gets forgotten. And then checking the line of sight of monsters makes it even worse. Once you start getting into that, realizing the monster's line of sight wraps the board. Plus, the wax eaters and the pathless have a whole system where they can chain off each other that when one goes off, if it hits another one, it goes off, and it actually makes a very Bomberman-like explosion of darkness and stuffed candles, which can be easy to miss.
This is another point where the quarterbacking can creep in, especially if not everyone at the table has played it as often. Missing, forgetting, or confusing rules can mean that bad choices and negative effects for the entire group. So you have to run a fine line between helping understand the game and helping play the game.
And to be fair, what would be nice for this game is to have a third party be able to be there to help teach the game instead of playing it. That way they can be impartial and just correct rule mistakes or forgotten things. Like I said, the biggest thing is forgetting to do something. Now, I started this review with the potential pitfalls of the game, because other than those issues, which are only going to be a problem for some groups, it's going to be very group dependent. This game, more so than many other horror games, does exactly what it sets out to do, and that is making a horror game that actually has an emotional effect on you. It actually affects your feelings. It actually creates appropriate emotions from watching a horror movie or reading a horror novel. Night Cage does this and does it well. While playing, you will get feelings of isolation, disorientation, hopelessness. You may also feel panic when you get near the end of the game, and feeling anxious is to be expected while playing.
Now, one thing that took me out of this incredible feeling that the game can create was the dummy player rules. Now, if you're playing this game with anything less than four players, there are dummy players. And I found that frustrating. I found it increased the quarterbacking potential and lessened the anxiety as you were taken out of your personal character peril to deal with another character. Personally, for me, four or five players is the only way I'm actually interested in playing this game as a result of that dummy player issue.
So if you're looking for a horror-themed game to add to your collection, for themed game nights, for something to play during the Halloween season, or because you just feel like being spooked from time to time, Night Cage is well worth picking up. Due to the built-in scalability, it can be a good choice for a wide range of groups of different ages and play experience.
If you think board games can't make you anxious or impose the feeling of watching a good horror movie on you, then I definitely encourage you to give this one a try.
Now, I also found this game to be great for people like me who host public play game nights. The striking art style and that level of tension, just the way the players are reacting and the sounds they make, really sticks out as a group in the corner playing this creepy game that people not currently playing the game will wander over. Every time I've gotten one group to play this, other people over to see what's going on. And then usually when that game ends, they ask to play next.
As well, in a public play setting, you're more likely to be able to get those group sizes the game was really designed for.
Now, if you're not a fan of cooperative games, stay far away, especially if the main complaint you have is quarterbacking. Even with the limited communication rules, this is a game about working together that has a strong puzzle element, and players trying to help each other is just part of the game.
Now that we've illuminated you on the Night Cage and no one is left in the dark, let me ask you this. What's a horror game that you've played that actually thematically appropriate feelings? What creates a thematically appropriate feelings? What's a game that actually scared you, made you feel isolated or lost? Have you ever been jump scared by a board game? We want to hear about it in the comments below.
You can also reach out to us on our Discord server through email, mo@tabletopbellhop.com. Or hit me up on social media where I can be found everywhere as Tabletop Bellhop, one word.
Help us to keep shedding the light on a variety of board games through our Patreon at patreon.com/tabletopbellhop.